Tonight, a tour of the Ozone on board the Moog train. It's an odyssey in which Andy Moog's become a folk hero. In part flippant, in part banal. In the opening round, the heavily favored Bruins relied on their last line of defense to hang on against Hartford. But from that point through the present, Moog and the Bruins have been virtually flawless. In this series against the Canadians, a 20-save performance netted Andy his first playoff shutout ever. Then in the Whales clash with Washington, he experienced deja vu in Game 2, blanking the Caps on 28 shots. Andy Moog has come from BC's Okanagan to DC's Chesapeake Bay to give his team the upper hand in a Prince of Wales final, where a warm heart and cold champagne will both be on ice for Boston tonight.
Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
And the Wesley scores! Wesley for Boston!
Shot is blocked by Gartner. Langley has it back. Langley cuts it.
Shoots! He scores!
By Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Ford of Canada, where quality is more than a commitment. Quality is job one. By
Asimov was a starter last night. The Oilers' first Soviet played only one shift. A power play gets the Oilers on the board. Steve Smith shoots from the point. Glenn Anderson with a perfect tip-in. 1-0 Oilers. Oilers extend their lead on a great individual effort by Mark Messier. Messier breaks down the wing and Doug Wilson can't cut him off. Two goals on Greg Millen in three shots. Hawks with the man advantage late in the first. Dennis Savard shows his touch from the side of the goal. Chicago trails 2-1 after one. Oilers restore their two-goal lead 11 seconds into period two. Millen misplays the puck, and Craig Simpson jams it in. 3-1 Oilers. Captain Hook yanks Millen in favor of Jacques Luce. Hawks close the gap again. Ruotsalainen's pass is intercepted. Jeremy Roenick is there and picks the far corner. 3-2. That didn't slow the Oilers down, as Messier is sent in on a breakaway. He beats Kluche with a backhand. 4 points for the Oilers' captain. Hawks frustrated late in the game. Jocelyn Lemieux runs goalie Bill Ranford into the glass. Ranford has a headache, and Lemieux is assessed a boarding major. Oilers coast the rest of the way, downing Chicago 4-2, and even the series at two games apiece. Bruce Buchanan, ITV Sports.
And the Oilers boarded a plane right after the game in Chicago, held an optional practice today, which most of the vets skipped. The club will also have a team meeting today, and they were very pleased about what happened last night in Chicago.
I think we stepped it up another notch for game four from the intensity side, but I think probably the main difference was that we were able to capitalize on our chances, which we weren't in game three, through good goaltending and, you know, much better game out of the Hawks.
It was 2 out of 3.
In your home, not just for the rest of your hockey career, but your home, period. We'd also like you to help us send that message. So send us a card or fax the message.
Hundreds of Edmontonians are getting involved trying to persuade the Oilers management to keep number 17 right here. The star forward is in his option year. And unless contract talks prove fruitful, he'll be down the highway.
I don't think there's any doubt about the fact that we can have some influence on them. This is a matter of money, of course, and negotiation, but we want to let Yari know and the Oilers management know that we want Yari to stay here in Edmonton, and we want everybody to participate.
Welcome to Bob and Ernie's.
Oh, hi.
How are you doing? Have you going to win tonight?
Oh, I take it for granted.
Over at Bob and Ernie's on the south side, patrons are dishing out support for Curry, signing a massive petition, which will be passed on to Oldies 1260.
It would be a shame that he just ups and leaves and no one makes a fuss over it. Because I'm sorry, he's done a lot for the city just as Gretzky has. It was Gretzky and Curry, it wasn't just Gretzky.
Go, Oilers, go! Oilers number one! Yeah!
About 30 employees at Alberta Public Works have gone wild, decorating their entire office floor and adding to Edmonton's tidal wave.
We dress up every time the Oilers have a game, and it's great. Their spirit is just fabulous. It's a good time. It makes work fun.
But what's this?
I'm trying,
a traitor in their midst?
My loyalty, I have to stay loyal where I'm loyal.
And you're not frightened about the consequences?
Well, this is why I'm wearing my survival buttons here.
There are some in Edmonton who overdress and have to undress to show their support.
Every time I've worn this shirt and I've worked and the game's been on television or here, we have won. I'm wearing it today. So what does that mean tonight? We're going to win.
And then there are some who just need a simple push in the right direction.
Who are you rooting for the Stanley Cup?
The Stanley Cup, is that a yacht race or soccer or...
Time for that 7:30. Chris Cuthbert is down at Northlands. Let's check in with him now, Chris.
Okay, Joanne, thank you, and good evening, everybody. Kelly Buchberger will be back in the Oiler lineup tonight. He'll replace Anatoly Semenov. And it looked like John Muckler would also need a replacement for Martin Jelena when the Oilers rookie missed practice this morning. Al Nagy reports.
Kelly Buchberger had been playing the best hockey of his life when he was injured in Game 2 of this series. It looked bad, a dislocated shoulder, and it appeared as if Buchberger's season was over.
He appears to be in considerable pain.
But the pain is gone. Buchberger has recovered, and he'll be back in the lineup tonight.
The way I play is an aggressive way to play hockey, and you know, you're bound to get a couple of injuries, but unfortunately, I got hit the wrong way and my shoulder popped back out, but it feels good now, and it feels just as strong as it was when I first heard it. So,
Kelly is kind of an inspiration to our hockey club. He likes to cause a little havoc. He plays very well along the boards. He plays well in front of the net. He's a sound defensive player on his own end. He's a great checker, and he's capable of scoring some goals for us.
And for a while today, it looked like the Oilers might also have to find a replacement for Martin Jelena. There was genuine concern when the youngster did not show up for practice. The Oilers sent someone over to Jelena's house to bang in the door. There was no answer. Finally, Jelena did show up at the Oilers dressing room. Better late than never.
You wouldn't want something like an accident to happen, so we're all glad to see he's all right.
We were all concerned about Martin Jelena this morning. What happened?
Well, he's 19 years old, and you know, those young kids, they need about 20 hours sleep, so he overslept.
Maybe it'll help him tonight.
Oh, I'm sure he'll probably get a hat trick tonight.
That is, of course, if he remembers to set his alarm clock before his afternoon nap. In Edmonton, Al Nagy, CBC Sports.
Funny, I only need about 12 hours sleep a night. Now back
in Canada and the Stanley Cup playoffs.
The view of these Stanley Cup playoffs is now three-dimensional with the trio of teams still in contention. Last night, the Bruins confirmed their place in the Cup Final, sweeping aside the Washington Capitals. Cam Neely scored in each game against the Caps, twice in Game 4. That, along with an unyielding Boston defense, gave the Bruins a 3-2 victory, and it was series over in Landover. Still to be claimed is the Clarence Campbell Bowl, with this conference final all tied up. Tuesday night in Game 4, Mike Keenan was fit to be tied as John Muckler regained home ice advantage. The mark of excellence, number 11, displayed his heart and Hart Trophy qualifications with 2 goals and 2 assists, raising his point total to 22, almost single-handedly tying the series at 2. Tonight from Northlands Coliseum, it's Game 5 of the Campbell Conference Final. The footing was unsteady for the goaltenders as the Oilers regained a foothold in this series. Bill Ranford was fortunate to shake off this open season hit from Jocelyn Lemieux, which could have ended Ranford's postseason. Meanwhile, Mike Keenan's goaltending situation continued to be hit and miss. For the fifth time in the playoffs, Greg Millen was a victim of Captain Hook, pulled 11 seconds into the second period. Jacques Lucci made his second relief appearance, allowing 1 goal and earning the number one job tonight, while second-round hero Eddie the Eagle Belfour remains perched in the press box. Tonight, the puck stops here in Edmonton for Game 5 on Hockey Night in Canada.
Brought to you by Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Ford of Canada, where quality is more than a commitment, quality is job one.
by Esso, going that extra mile. And by Pepsi, it's got what it takes.
Stanley Cup tonight from the Northlands Coliseum. The Oilers and Blackhawks begin a best of three series to decide the Boston Bruins' final round opponent. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC in the fifth game of the Campbell Conference Final. It's interesting to note that the three teams remaining in the Stanley Cup chase all survived seventh game scares in round one, and the Blackhawks went seven in round two, the Norris Final against the St. Louis Blues. This series, too, could go to the limit, but right now it's tied 2-2, and in the same position as it was in 1985 when these two teams met. The Oilers winning games 1-4, the Hawks 2-3. Both teams have won on the road, and both teams have scored 13 goals in the series. Not much to choose between the two, but the Oilers do have home ice advantage, two wins here at Northlands, and they move on against the Boston Bruins. With their thoughts, let's go upstairs and join Don Whitman and Scotty Bowman.
Thanks, Chris. Hi, everybody. It's been almost 48 hours since the Oilers squared this series with a strong performance from Mark Messier at Chicago Stadium. People are talking about the Oilers captain. The Oilers, in glowing terms, the Blackhawks, are less than complimentary.
Well, Mike Keenan showed films to supervisor John D'Amico the fact that Messier gave quite a bit in that game. He felt he took just as much as he gave. And when you look what he did in the first period, 9 minutes and 40 seconds, he logged an overall 25 minutes in the game, so he was ready to go all out. He and Tikkanen did such a great job against Denis Savard.
Messier, two goals, two assists. Denis Savard had been the star of games 2 and 3. The Oilers felt they had to shut him down in game 4, and the man who drew the job of shadowing Denis Savard was Esa Tikkanen.
Played 22 minutes, but what they did is they used Messier in the first period against Savard some of the time, and he was concerned about Messier's offense. And then he had Tikkanen after the Oilers took the lead going after him in the defensive zone of Edmonton. So it was a tough night for Denis Savard having to play against Tikkanen and Messier.
And now let's reach into the hat and draw out the name of tonight's starting goaltender. That's not the way Mike Keenan did it, but some think he might have. Jacques Cloutier gets the call.
Well, he feels that his team would be very supportive of Cloutier. There isn't a coach that Cloutier has played under that didn't feel comfortable with him in the net. So he's an experienced goaltender, hasn't started a game in the playoffs, yet has come in twice and done very well in a relief role.
So Jacques Cloutier is the starting goaltender tonight. Greg Millen is the backup. Game 5 in the Campbell Conference Final is next as the 1990 Stanley Cup playoff continues in a moment.
Welcome back to Edmonton as our Stanley Cup tradition continues. Game 5 straight ahead, but first the national anthem. And here is Anna
Bring at 2:08. Then on the power play, Simpson made it 2-0 at 12:25. Blackhawks came back with Steve Conroy getting his first playoff goal at 14-14, but just 18 seconds later, Adam Graves on the wraparound restored Edmonton's two-goal advantage as they outshot the Hawks 15-4 in the opening period. Craig Simpson will be Chris Cuthbert's first intermission guest. And the score at the end of the first period, the Edmonton Oilers 3 and the Chicago Blackhawks won.
So many times, one times it just overpowers Jacques Cloutier.
That's playoff career goal number 89 for Yari Curry, and that ties him for the lead all time with Wayne Gretzky.
They had a tremendous power play going, and you saw Curry just a nice little play into the corner. The Messier, and he just really drills it. Cloutier can't move, and that's the bread and butter play for the Oilers, and Curry's able to move. Nobody takes him, but Messier put enough on it, and I was surprised that Curry could one-time it so well.
Well, Yari Curry took that hit in the opening. Yanni, unassisted at 4:03, made it a 3-2 game. Then Savard on the power play tied it before Curry, with his 89th career playoff goal on the power play, put the Oilers in front at 18-29. Coming up next, a national news update with Peter Mansbridge. The score at the end of the second period, the Edmonton Oilers 4, the Chicago...
After an impressive comeback...
...marks in winning 4 Stanley Cups in the 1980s.
And what does it take to dominate the NHL's second season? Well, having a Wayne Gretzky in the lineup certainly doesn't hurt, but the Oilers have had much more. Hockey's version of the Magnificent Seven, Curry, Messier, Anderson, Lowe, Gregg, Huddy, and Fuhr, are still around from the first Cup win in 1984 and have provided the Oilers with that all-important intangible experience. And that certainly made the difference this year when the Oilers trailed the Jets 3-1 in the opening round and eliminated Winnipeg with a victory in the seventh game.
I think it's really, really important.
A low from which many thought the club would have great difficulty recovering. But this season, a new leader has emerged.
Messier racing after it. Wilson trying to cut him off. Messier scores!
Trailing the Blackhawks 2-1, Messier once again raised his game and used his experience to lead the Oilers to yet another big victory in a must-win situation.
We've been doing this for now. This is probably my 11th year now.
With it in the first period, Gregg and Simpson scoring for a 2-0 lead. But then Chicago came back with a goal by Steve Conroy. However, 18 seconds later, Adam Graves made it a 3-1 game, and that's the way the first period ended, with the Oilers dominating, outshooting the Hawks 16-4. In the second period, Troy Murray and Savard on the power play tied it before Yari Curry got what proved to be the winner on the power play, 18:29, the time of the goal, his 89th career playoff goal, tying him with Wayne Gretzky for the lead in that department. No scoring in the third period. The Oilers overall outshooting the Hawks by a margin of 34-21. So the Oilers take a 3-2 lead in games. In just a moment, our Molson three-star selection.
Might be the best game of the series, certainly the most bruising, and the Oilers emerge 4-3 winners to take a 3-2 series lead. Here are the Molson three stars of tonight's game. Kevin Lowe led the defensive core that was airtight in the third period, particularly impressive with the injury to Randy Gregg. They logged a lot of ice time tonight. Yari Curry, star number 2, with the game-winning goal, number 89 of his distinguished playoff career. And not much doubt about Denny Savard's character tonight. He had a goal and 1 assist in a losing cause. Well, a great hockey game here at the Northlands Coliseum tonight. The Armitage.
For his first shift of the hockey game, back on the point. He gets the pass from Deschene, back to Deschene. He fired it into the corner. Granato with a shot, the save by Bill Ranford. Fraser manages to keep it in at the blue line. Back to the point, Sandstrom tees it up, fires it wide. Kontos back to Fraser. There's his shot, a weak one, as that puck was up on edge and it was knocked out.
$1 worth of property was stolen from vehicles parked at the mall. So police have launched a special campaign to curb crime in the parking lot. Wendy Taberes reports.
Petty thieves love to shop at West Edmonton Mall. Shop in the parking lots, that is. Where else can you pick up goods that don't have to be paid for? And since most people don't record the serial numbers on their property, getting caught is nearly impossible.
It is a problem. It's a problem everywhere. It's up to us now to look at those numbers and see what we can do to bring them down.
6-1 here. I'm on entrance 32, east side, fishing hole.
Hopefully, people like Maureen Spooner, a volunteer member of the Community Police Radio Network, will help. 3 network cars will be patrolling the parking lot along with extra mall security guards over the next couple of weeks.
The underground, in the parkades, way in the corners. Areas a lot of people don't look for.
You'll also notice signs warning of the potential risks dotted throughout the parking lot. And the police have even added another foot patrol constable. But the onus to protect property still lies with the owner.
There's people that are leaving their cars insecure here as well with the property exposed. I'd suggest that there's probably an area 60% of the people that attend this mall are from rural areas outside of Edmonton.
Like this lady, who's visiting from out of town.
No, I don't. I haven't taken any precautions at all.
Why not?
I haven't thought about it, I guess.
but city police are hoping shoppers will start thinking about it. And if this campaign is a success, there's a good chance it will be expanded into other shopping center parking lots later this year.
Now, city police are trying to do something about it. As Alana Riddick reports, they're hoping a pilot program at West Edmonton Mall will cut the number of thefts.
Smashing a window, popping the lock. It doesn't take more than a few seconds to break into a locked car, and catching the culprits isn't easy.
Don't catch very many.
So West Edmonton Mall has become the target of a new program to try and cut down the number of car break-ins.
We're not the only ones in the city that have a problem here, but we're the ones that are being targeted for this program because we're one of the biggest.
During a two-month study, Edmonton police discovered that $69,000 worth of property was stolen from cars parked here at the mall, mostly car stereos, radar detectors, and items left sitting out in the open.
Under the new program, community volunteers are patrolling the mall parking lots, telling shoppers how to protect their valuables. Even the Alberta Motor Association is helping out. It's chipped in $3,000 for the signs posted around parking lots, warning shoppers of the problem.
And the people who lose those items aren't the only losers. The careful drivers who lock their car and put belongings out of sight also lose, and the loss probably contributes to increased insurance premiums.
Edmonton police plan to review the program at the end of August. If it's a success, they'll consider expanding it to other shopping malls throughout the city. Alana Riddick, CBC News.
The problem has always existed, but the review showed just how major it was.
Though I think before that time, there hadn't been any study done within the parking lot to get any numbers for exactly what was happening. It is a problem. It's a problem everywhere. It's up to us now to look at those numbers and see what we can do to bring them down.
In addition to the increased patrols, the Alberta Motor Association is providing signs warning patrons of the risks and advising them of ways to reduce or avoid those risks.
The areas at Woodward's and the Bourbon Street area have been identified as a higher concern because of the fact that there are three levels of parking and there is a lot of dark areas at the back of the lot, so they would like us to cover those areas in particular.
There's a message here for thieves. Don't do it. Someone may be watching.
Fred Randy Gray cruising in, and he surprises Jacques Cloutier, 1-0 just over 2 minutes in. Oilers on a power play. Ruud Salainen's drive from the point is tipped in front by Craig Simpson. Simpson's 11th playoff goal, 2-0 Oilers. Hawks had limited chances in the first, but they make the most of this one. Larmer passes to Steve Conroy, and he directs the puck past Bill Ranford, 2-1. But 18 seconds later, Adam Graves with the wraparound, and Oilers regain their two-goal lead, 3-1 after one. Hawks pull within a goal in the second. Brantford's clearing attempt is kept in by Trent Yanni. His shot is deflected by Troy Murray, and it's 3-2. They get even 8 minutes later. Dennis Savard tees one up on a power play. The puck hits Kevin Lowe and eludes Ranford, 3-3. Oilers with a man advantage late in the second. Yari Curry and Messier work the give and go, and Curry buries it from the slot. Curry's 89th career playoff goal, tying him with Wayne Gretzky on the all-time list. Curry received a
Stanley Cup. In Canada and the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Three's a crowd as the Stanley Cup final approaches with Boston awaiting the Campbell Conference champion. Last Tuesday, the Oilers took another step towards a second meeting with the Bruins in 3 years, winning in Chicago to regain home ice advantage. Thursday, the Oilers appeared to own the ice as they opened up a 3-1 first period lead. It was a rocky start for Mike Keenan, his team on the ropes, his star center down for the count. In a critical game, you expect to see stars, and once revived, Denny Savard led the Hawks to a second period revival. He displayed great playoff savvy with a goal and an assist to draw Chicago even at 3 apiece. But later in the second period, an old sidekick of Wayne Gretzky moved alongside number 99 in the record book with an historic winning goal. Tonight from Chicago, it's game 6 of the Campbell Conference Championship.
And Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
And the Wesley scores! Wesley for Boston!
Shot is blocked by Gardner. Langway has it back. Langway cuts it. Shoots! He scores!
Scores! In front of the net. Messier to Curry. On top and he scores!
Oilers' top 20 are known for their slick skating but can march to the beat of a different drum. In Game 5, the Oilers' band leader, Mark Messier, set the tempo with this smash hit. Jeremy Roenick and Glenn Anderson waged a vicious breakdance. And the hit parade continues as Cam Russell wraps Craig Gibson. Tonight, the heavy beat goes on in Chicago, where the number one song on the playlist is the American National Anthem. A return home should be music to the ears of the Blackhawks. Here at the stadium, the Hawks ended the first two rounds on winning notes and hope tonight isn't their playoff swan song. Live on Hockey Night in Canada, it's Game 6 of the Conference Final.
Brought to you by Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Ford of Canada, where quality is more than a commitment. Quality is job one. By Esso, going that extra mile. And by Pepsi, it's got what it takes.
Welcome to the Thunderdome, Chicago Stadium.
A lot of scoring chances in the game I thought would be a lot tighter. And from the left went Asatikin and scored a shorthanded goal, 2:01 into the game, and then a pair of power play goals. Roenick for the Hawks to tie it. Simpson putting the Oilers ahead at 12:26 and completing the first period scoring. Peter Klima's fourth goal of the playoffs at 15:11 as the Oilers outshot the Hawks by a margin of 15:11. Coming up in our first intermission, the Blackhawks' Troy Murray guesting with Chris Cuthbert. Let's check the scoring summary of the second period. Graves deflecting the shot by Huddy at 5:17 to make it 4-1. Then Murphy at 15:22, Anderson at 17:31, and completing the scoring in the second period, Messier at 17:48, as the Oilers outshot the Hawks 10-6, 25-17 through 40 minutes of play. Coming up next, the national news update with Knowlton Nash. The score at the end of the second period at Chicago Stadium is Edmonton 7, Chicago 1.
Creighton able to get there as it looked like confusion was in there, and finally just losing that puck.
Here we go. Hey, Brian.
I just want to congratulate you fellas on three great series. This is the sixth time in the last 8 years that you've done this. It's a remarkable feat. And we're very pleased on behalf of the league to present you with the Clarence Campbell Trophy, emblematic of winning this conference. Congratulations to all of you.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you
very much.
Great. Thank you.
What are you doing? I'd just like to accept this on behalf of my teammates, and it's a small step to our goal that we started out at the start of the year, which is the Stanley Cup, and this is just a small goal towards it. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. Come on, Aaron. Good job.
Hey, go, Buck.
Hey, John.
Puck. Presentation just begun.
The second star tonight, Mark Messier, also with a three-point evening on the strength of a goal and two assists. And the third star tonight, the Oilers make it a sweep.
Championship. So the Stanley Cup matchup is set, and so are the dates. We'll start with Game 1 on Tuesday night, Game 2 Friday. Now, good night from Chicago.
In Canada on CBC was brought to you by Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Esso, makers of high performance Esso Supreme gasoline. And by Pepsi, it's got what it takes.
Dernier but dans la deuxième période, celui-là à 17:45. 10 tirs par les Oilers, 8 par les Blackhawks. En troisième période, Chicago a eu un petit regain d'énergie. Creighton à 1:31, mais Steve Smith a redonné l'avance de 6 buts tout de suite aux Oilers d'Edmonton. Thomas est venu marquer à 8:11, aidé de Lemieux et Graham. Et avant que ça se termine, Trent Yanné y allait de son troisième des séries, aidé de Roenick et Presley à 9:04. 3 tirs seulement par les Oilers, 13 par les Blackhawks. Notre prochain reportage, mardi 15.
One-year vacation, Stanley Cup fever has returned to Edmonton. For the sixth time in the past 8 years, the Oilers are vying for hockey's holy grail. And as Chris Durham reports tonight, it's a feeling the city is getting used to.
Thank you.
Meet Steve Corcoran, his crazy friends, and the Oilermobile, Steve's four-wheel creation to rev up Oiler enthusiasm on city streets. Steve bought the fan wagon for a loony and has made it his personal mission to kick fans into high gear. It's not that Oiler fever isn't already alive in Edmonton. Steve just wants to help spread the bug.
I think a wee push wouldn't be bad. They're a little reserved still. Not too, they probably don't think they're going to get it or not, so.
But you're sure that we're going to get it?
Oh, we'll be celebrating for sure.
Following the Oilers' blowout of the Hawks in the Windy City on Saturday, Edmonton fans have been rising to the occasion. Signs are going up all across town, and team colors are in high demand. Lord Stanley's mug is within our grasp once again, and fans are reaching out for some of the action. So too are city restaurants and hotels. The most likely will feel the biggest windfall over the coming week.
It's like having Elvis Presley live 11 more times this year. The place will be full, the facility across the road will be full, all of our outlets will be full, the bedrooms will be full. It's a plus-plus for the four men.
From a dollar standpoint, city businesses also hope to bask in the glow of hockey's biggest spotlight.
On the promotional side, there's no doubt that it brings hundreds of thousands of dollars in promotional value for the city of Edmonton. I mean, clearly, over the years, the Edmonton Oilers have put Edmonton on the world map. Not everybody's sure whereabouts on the map we are, but they put us there.
Tickets for Game 3 and 4 in Edmonton go on sale Wednesday morning. While the Oilers can't guarantee a fifth Stanley Cup, they do.
Years ago, it was no contest. The Oilers took the series 4-0 and walked off with their fourth Stanley Cup. Well, a few things have changed since then. Now it's the Bruins, not the Oilers, who are the favorites heading into the series. And, of course, we don't have Wayne anymore. But still, as Brett Harris reports, there's little doubt in Edmonton today that history is about to repeat itself.
It wasn't all smooth sailing for the Oilers 2 years ago. Game 4 at the Boston Gardens. It's 3-2. The Oilers score to tie it up, but seconds later, the lights go out, and they stay out. The game had to be rescheduled. Even with three games in hand, it's the kind of thing that could have thrown the Oilers off track, but it didn't. The Oilers took the cup in what will probably go down in history as the only 4.5-game sweep ever. There was Oiler fever in Edmonton all the way throughout the series, but that night, Jasper Avenue erupted into an Oiler frenzy. A few fans even got carried away. Here in Edmonton today, nobody seemed to be getting carried away with Oiler fever.
I'm pretty calm about it.
Think there's a bit of Oiler frenzy going in town, or is it kind of laid back?
If there is, I've missed it.
Well, I think we're kind of getting used to winning. Well, that sounds kind of arrogant, but we've won a couple Stanley Cups. I think the first two were the most exciting.
But most Edmontonians are still keeping the faith.
Taking predictions, okay. Oh, boy. I say Oilers in 7.
Edmonton in 6. They'll be there.
4 games, yes. Okay. Absolutely.
So who are you rooting for?
Boston in 6.
How come?
I just think they're a better team.
Do you have Oilers fever?
No. Boston fever.
How come? How come you think they're going to win?
Who knows? I've been a faithful fan for years.
Are you from Edmonton?
So-so.
So what's your prediction for the series?
Boston in 6.
What about you?
I'm an Edmonton fan. I think they got the firepower to beat them, actually. It's going to be a damn tough series, but I think they're going to do it in 6.
Brett Harris, CBC News, Edmonton.
As for the Oilers, they're already in Boston.
The underdogs.
Yeah, quite a bit different. We're happy to be here to start off with. And I think out of the 6 years, it's probably been one of the most exciting years for me to see the team evolve over the course of the year to the point where we are now challenging for the Cup.
The Oilers' style hasn't changed that much since 1988. They still favor the wide-open style, even though the cast is different. As for the Boston Bruins, they're still a tight defensive team. They won't be much different than they were in 1988, except maybe for their attitude.
Don't be satisfied with being in the finals. I mean, it's a great feeling, but, that was my mistake. I'm in the finals, and I was happy to be there instead of a little hungrier.
Revenge sweep in 1988, and for the Oilers to prove that they can change the nucleus of this team and still win. Gord Miller, Cup Playoffs. Will contest the Stanley Cup for the sixth time in 8 years after a 4-2 series win over Chicago. The Boston Bruins won their cup berth by winning the Wales Conference in 4 straight games over Washington. Over a period of 6 playoff weeks, the number of teams in the tournament has dwindled to 2. Tonight, it's a meeting of those remaining men who sport stainless steel beneath them and dream of hoisting silver. The boys of the 1988 final have resurfaced in 1990 as we present the Stanley Cup Championships Game 1 from Boston.
Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Franchise with 4 cups and a club with a cult following, the Oilers and Bruins face-to-face, starring the new kid on the block, former Bruin Bill Ranford, and the old kid on the block, former Oiler Andy Moog. 1979 first-round draft pick Kevin Lowe. 1979 first-round draft pick Ray Bourque. The heady one from Helsinki, Jari Kurri. The heady one from Hartford, Craig Janney. And a pair of raging bulls, the Oilers' Mark Messier and the one who has mirrored his ways, Boston's Cam Neely. Tonight, it's a command performance at Lord Stanley's request.
Brought to you by Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Ford of Canada, where quality is more than a commitment, quality is job one. By Esso, going that extra mile. And by Pepsi. It's got what it takes.
When they met in 1988, they broke out champagne in Edmonton, while in Boston they settled for a tea party. One wants a rerun, one wants revenge, as the Bruins and the Oilers.
Curry, Klima catching up. He's in. She scores. Klima. The goal for the Edmonton Oilers here in the third overtime at 15-13. And what a win this has got to be for the Edmonton Oilers. Klima with the goal. And the Oilers win it.
I'm Warren Michaels in Edmonton. Even while the game was still on, scalpers and fans were camped out at the Coliseum to get the first crack at tickets for the home games. They even played a little hockey themselves, and loyalties were divided. Boston! 8:30 this morning, it was time to get up, have some breakfast, pack up belongings, and do a little more chanting. Then the big moment. And within a few seconds, big money and tickets were changing hands.
You happy?
All you people who are my friends and know me, I got the tickets. And if you're a great-looking girl, I got the tickets.
Jessie Wyatt and her daughter picked up 24 tickets, including 5 goals. Why do you need 24 tickets?
Well, because I'm going to... don't ask me that.
Are you going to sell them?
Yeah.
The profit? Well, she expects to make $1,500 to $2,000. With scalpers at the front of the line and lots of other folks wanting tickets, those at the back were worried.
You're at the end of the line. What do you think you're going to get here?
I don't know. I'm looking to get tickets for Father's Day for my husband.
But Kim Bilston and her husband got shut out, and they'll be watching the game on Sunday at home. So who do these fans think is going to win?
Oh, Edmonton's got a great hockey club, but they got lucky last night, and Boston's going to beat them in seven.
I hope it's all Oilers four straight and have the cup hoisted on Tuesday night, but I think actually it's going to be at least six games.
Meanwhile, in St. Albert, as Oiler fever spreads, an old watering hole, the Bruin Inn, has changed its name.
They're going to win the cup, and we want to do our part to help them.
They're all pumped and ready to go, like, we're going to get it. We're going to do it. Oilers in four. Woo!
St. Albert is the hometown of Marc Messier, but it's also where Bruins defenseman Greg Hoggett grew up. His father says he's been taking some ribbing, but he's not worried.
Funny, I talked to him on Sunday, and of course it was Mother's Day, and he phoned home, and I said, when you guys win the Stanley Cup and you get your ring, can I wear it for a week? And he said, yes, you can, Dad. So I just hope they do win it and I get a chance to wear a ring.
A Stanley Cup win by the Bruins would also be welcome news to those few brave souls willing to bet against the Oilers.
I got to pay again today.
So you've been betting on the old Bruins.
I haven't been betting on anybody but the Oilers, and I haven't been too successful.
Boston's Andy Moog and the Oilers' Bill Ranford, both spectacular. Oilers open the scoring midway through the first period. Murphy to Adam Graves. He beats Andy Moog, and it is 1-0 visitors. There is plenty of hitting last night. Neely lays on to Craig Muni, then Muni will come right back and put the body into John Carter. Esa-Tiikkanen did a good job in slowing down Craig Janne. Maybe a little too good here. Tiikkanen gets 2 minutes in the penalty box. At the 13-minute mark of the second period, the Oilers reeling a bit when Messier had the pass to Glenn Anderson, and like the Anderson of old, he scores, making it 2-0. The Bruins finally got one past Ranford. At 3:43 of the third period, Neely to Bork to Hoggett, back to Bork, and the Bruins cut into the Oilers' lead. It's 2-1. Then with 1:29 left in the third period, Ray Bork gets the pass from Neely and buries it, and that will set the stage for a long overtime. In the second OT, a chance I'm sure that kept Glenn Wesley awake in the wee hours of the morning, has a ton of net, but fires it over top. Ranford and the Oilers breathe a sigh of relief late in that period. Yari Curry shaken up earlier. Andy Moog shuts the door. Then in the third overtime, a bank of lights on the south side of the old Boston Garden went out. A little deja vu from a couple of years ago, if you remember. Referee Don Koharski will talk it over with both coaches, Muckler and Milbury, and eventually the teams would leave the ice, but they would return, and the Oilers actually thought they had won it soon afterwards. Murphy has a couple of whacks of the puck. Graves will get it in, but referee Koharski says no goal, and the game is still tied at 2. Billy Ranford razor sharp last night. Here he foils Brian Propp, one of 50 saves he made last night. Then at 15:13, triple overtime, Oilers on a 3-on-2. Curry drops it off for Peter Klima, and he scores one of the biggest goals in Oiler history, certainly the biggest of his NHL career. The Oilers won 3-2, ending the longest overtime game in the Stanley Cup Final.
We had 3-on-2, and I just tried to make the good shot. I saw the hole between his legs, and I just tried to hit the hole, you know. Game like that, you can't just shoot on the net. You gotta, because the goalie is tired, and I wasn't tired because I wasn't playing much, and just try to, you know.
Sports presents Hockey Night in Canada and the Stanley Cup Playoffs. Boston, Massachusetts is home to one of the world's most famous endurance exams. Tuesday, the city's reputation for gauging stamina took on an unusual twist in Game 1 at Boston Garden. Shortly after 8 o'clock, Adam Graves scored to give the Edmonton Oilers some daylight. At 8:45 p.m., it was daylight savings time, thanks to Bill Ranford. With the home team trailing by 2, Ray Bork did something good for the heart. He scored to make it 2-1. Moments later at the Oilers' bench, a flinch. Then at 10:11 p.m., Bork came around again. This time to square the affair at 2, which is how it remained through regulation. Now, only our imaginations would know limitations. As it said in the minutes, next goal wins. Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
21 wore on, the Warriors grew weary. The heat began to soar and was measured by degrees of difficulty. A hot hand was harder to find. There was an open invitation to close the deal, but the bid was too high. At the Bruins bench, a flinch. At 12:37 a.m., the lights went out, a tradition on this circuit, allowing time to ponder the epic from a makeshift hammock or from wherever repose goes. Finally, at 1:26 a.m., Peter Klima scored to stop the clock for good. The Oilers were off and running after the longest game ever in a Stanley Cup final. Tonight, we're back in Boston where the Bruins race to keep pace.
Brought to you by Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Ford of Canada, where quality is more than a commitment. Quality is job one. By Esso, going that extra mile. And by Pepsi, it's got what it takes.
And the score at the end of the first period. Edmonton Oilers, 2, and the Boston Bruins, 1.
Getting some advice on how to beat Lemelin. Well, that's how good a series Ranford's having, Bob. They're asking him how to score goals now.
5-2 is the score. Favor of Edmonton. Here's Klima. Period. They outshot the Boston Bruins. All the way into the second. Edmonton, 6.
Have gone on to win the cup in 31 of 34 series. Sunday night will bring you the start, 6 o'clock local time, 8 o'clock Eastern. Thanks for watching, and good night.
Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC was brought to you by Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Esso, makers of high-performance Esso Supreme Gasoline. And by Pepsi, it's got what it takes.
Avec l'aide de Greg et Murphy à 8:38. Ensuite, Yari Curry, son 90e en séries éliminatoires, aidé de Tikkanen à 10:53. Et ensuite, Raymond Bourque de Neely à 19:07. C'était son 5e de la saison. Et en deuxième, maintenant, Hargood y allait de son premier dans les séries lors d'une attaque massive a été de Burridge et Bourque à 2 minutes 56. C'était donc l'égalité 2-2. Et le gros but du match, celui de Yari Curry, son 9e, flanqué de Tikkanen à 4-21. Ensuite, ça se poursuit. Simpson de Curry et Lem à 15-28. Tikkanen y allait de son 11e, flanqué de Curry à 17-10. Et ensuite, Murphy, son 5e, aidé de Smith à 19-12. 12-9 les tirs au but. Et en troisième, un seul but, celui de Yari Curry, le tour du chapeau pour lui, son 10e, aidé de Ruotsalainen, il aime à 7-27, 11-5 les tirs au but. Alors notre prochain rendez-vous du Northland Coliseum, c'est dimanche soir, 20h, heure de l'Est, pour le troisième match de cette série finale de la Coupe Stanley. Au nom de toute l'équipe, et le quatrième, oui, qui a lieu le mardi 22 mai, à compter de 21h. Au nom de toute l'équipe, bonsoir à tous, du Garden de Boston.
Fashion 60-minute game. Both teams came out flying. Glenn Anderson lays a hit on Cam Neely, and Neely bounces right back to take Esa Tikkanen heavily into the boards. Bruins press early. Glenn Wesley centers for Neely, but he can't find a hole in Ranford's armor. The Bruins control the play in the early going, but the Oilers will score in their first shot of the game. Adam Graves will beat Moog with a low slap shot. Oilers lead 1-0. And the Oilers will add to that lead on their second shot on Moog. The Bruins cough it up. Tikkanen to Yari Curry. He tips it in for his 90th career playoff goal. One more than his former linemate Wayne Gretzky. That one coming on the power play. The Bruins will also get on the board in the first frame. Neely gets it to Ray Bourque. He puts it upstairs. Ranford screen on the shot. Bourque has scored all three of Boston goals in the final to this point. Second period, though, Greg Haugood lets it go from the point. The screen in front. Haugood gets credit for his first of the playoffs. And we're tied at 2, but the Oilers get that one right back. Curry, his second of the night with a slap shot from well out. Soft-looking goal. The Oilers regain the lead. And that was it for Andy Moog. The Oilers get three shots and three goals on four shots. Moog gets the hook. Reggie Lemelin comes in to try his luck. Luck he doesn't have. He gets in trouble early with a bouncing puck, which almost proves very costly. A scary moment for the Bruins as Bourque gets heavily taken into the boards. He injures his ribs and didn't play much later in the game.
Things get even worse for the boys from Boston. Simpson scores, and it's 4-2 Oilers. Curry, red hot on his birthday. This time he sets up Tikkanen as Lemelin does not seem to be doing any better. Mike Milbury looking for more help on this play. Then Peter Klima, a breakaway chance. His stick was thrown by Lemelin. Klima on the breakaway on the penalty shot. A great move, and then he loses the puck. They didn't have to worry about Klima missing that tonight, as Joe Murphy will set up in front and fire the shot by Reggie Lemelin. The Oilers lead by a score of 6-2. And the Oilers will add the only goal scored in the third. Once again, Curry scores it. He records a hat trick on his birthday, adding two helpers. This a power play tally. The Oilers win by a convincing 7-2 final score. They steal both games in the Garden, heading back to Edmonton.
Burdusky has details.
Fans gathered early, hoping for a glimpse of their favorite Oilers stick handler.
I want to get my back signed by Steve Smith.
And 10-year-old Auburn Gray became the self-appointed timekeeper at the airport, counting down the minutes to the flight's 3:18 arrival.
I set my watch.
One Bruins backing baggage handler was nearly handled himself. Unsuspecting travelers on other flights were surprised by the reception.
So which one are you?
As the arrival time drew closer, Auburn grew excited.
11 or so more minutes before they get here. What do you think I'm here for?
I don't know.
Well?
Not for the Bruins.
Finally, it was 3:17 and counting.
3, 2, 1. Late. Late. Late.
But when the doors finally burst open, it was pure magic.
Feel good. There's no doubt about that. We're happy to be home.
And for little Auburn Gray, the day would be one she would surely cherish and remember for years to come.
I got Craig Muni and Bill Ranford, and I don't know who this is really.
So it was worth it.
Yes, it was. It was worth the wait.
The Oilers have until tomorrow night to rest up for Game 3 at the Northlands Coliseum. Till then, they'll appreciate all the fan support they can get. Ray Radowski, ITV News.
Couldn't find it, and Gretzky's waiting and saying, get down here as fast as you can. Look at Ranford, still hasn't turned around. Finally does, but by this time it's on the way into the net. And the LA Kings aren't out of this one yet. Still 1:09 left.
Well, Gretzky with patience and poise at the side of the net, waiting for that puck to come down to drop it to the ice and slide it past Bill Ranford. 1:09 remaining. That came with Mario Gosselin out of the net as the Kings sent out the extra attacker. And now Gosselin will return to the Los Angeles net for this faceoff. But as soon as that puck is flipped into the Edmonton zone, he'll be heading to the bench again. Duchesne and Sandstrom drawing the assists on Gretzky's third goal of the playoffs at 18:51.
The Oilers were guilty of trying to...
It's Hockey Night in Canada and the Stanley Cup Playoffs.
Following two games of the Stanley Cup Final, the Boston Bruins appeared to be Alberta bound for a burial. Mike Milbury's offense had been armed with plenty of shots, but too few goals. So entering Game 3, Milbury turned to Team B, and his scoring hunger ended fast. Milbury's ploy, not to mention the puck, had scarcely been put in play when rookie John Feist delivered a crowd-muzzling blow in 10 seconds of the first period. 15 minutes later, Greg Johnson, another recent addition, beat Bill Ranford, creating a margin of two for his mates. Guarding that lead became the obsession of B-team graduates like Gary Galley. A cast of heroes with little history of acclaim have signaled the Bruins are back as we get set for Game 4 in Edmonton.
Goals and Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Reynolds letters of intent from the C team of Bourque and Messier. The Bruins captain has kept his game face incognito throughout the playoffs, but so far each battle with Edmonton has taken on his complexion. In any zone, Bourque has been brilliant. What the Bruins have received from their 77, the Oilers now require from their number 11. That's a tall order, but Mark Messier is used to such heights. He's presently the target of static over stats, and although the scoring system may be to blame, Messier knows, and so does his head coach, that a more noticeable night from Messier is a must as we head to Game 4 of the 1990 Stanley Cup Final.
Brought to you by Molson Canadian, what beer's all about. By Ford of Canada, where quality is more than a commitment, quality is job one. By Esso, going that extra mile. And by Pepsi, it's got what it takes.
The Oilers filing onto the ice at Northlands Coliseum. As they did in Game 1, they hit the ice about a minute ahead of the Boston Bruins here this evening. Boston just leaving the locker room as we speak in anticipation of Game 4 of the Stanley Cup Final. Good evening and welcome to the Northlands Coliseum and the Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC and the Stanley Cup Championship Series. I'm Ron McLean. This whole thing began a week ago tonight at the Boston Garden. The turning point in that Game 1 in Boston came 6 hours after the opening faceoff. Well, in the first game here at Northlands Coliseum, the turning point arrived 10 seconds after they dropped the puck. In fact, if you look at the three games, there have been very few similarities in any, save for one, and that's been the unusual silence of the top guns, Cam Neely and Mark Messier. Messier says he has no injuries, although rumors are flying around Edmonton. Mark also declined the opportunity to provide on tape a pre-game comment about his goal-scoring drought, so instead we turn to head coach John Muckler.
Well, I think if you'd ask Mark, Mark would say that he probably hasn't played his best game yet in the series. I can relate back to the second game in Chicago when it was a real must game for our hockey club, and we weren't going to survive unless we won that particular night in Chicago, and Mark made a point of not letting this team lose. And I think we're in the same situation here tonight. I think Mark is going to come forth with a big game for us tonight. He never dodged a challenge. He knows there's a great challenge out there for him. And he's like any other superstar or any performer who is the best in his business, is that they love pressure and they play better under pressure.
Okay, John. Don, do you think Messier's hurt?
I think he's hurt a little. I think he had the flu. I think that he's hurt just a bit to keep him there. But remember, in the Chicago series, what's the matter with Messier? What's the matter, Messier? Fourth game, I think it was, won it by himself. Fourth game, let it go. I'm looking for a big game. I think the Oilers are going to come out smoking tonight.
What happened in that game Sunday night? And look ahead a bit.
Well, they fell asleep at the switch. 2-0 behind. That's the worst score in the world because you don't want to open up, get the third one. But what happened was they run into a hot goalie in the third period. If they do that again tonight, Moog will be hot again. Should be a beauty tonight. I'm looking for the best game of the series tonight.
Okay. Thank you, Grapes. Coming up, it's game
series.
On the goal, Anderson tried and just fell short.
Line has been awesome
is 8 on a power play at 2:13 from Simpson and Lamb. Anderson got his 9th of the playoffs at 16:27 from Messier and Simpson. There will be more to come from that line. Simpson this time at the 1 minute mark of the second from Messier and Anderson. Then Tekin had made it 4-0 at 19:15 from Curry and McTavish. Turner finally got one for Boston on assist.
What saw was a relaxed group of people hoping that the next game will be the last one of the season. And why not be happy when you're up 3-1 in the Stanley Cup final?
We feel we can win in that building, and coming from the Chicago series, we have a lot of confidence in the smaller buildings, and we're both skating teams, so I think the only advantage is obviously that that's their home building, but I think we both can play in there evenly, and we got just as good a chance as winning as they do.
We know we can beat them. If we play our best game, I think that's going to be good enough to win. If everybody's on top of their game and playing well, I think we'll be able to beat them, but anything short of that, and we're going to lose.
For players like McTavish and Glenn Anderson and many others, this is all old hat, but for some of the newcomers like Joe Murphy, it's a different experience. The spotlight of the Stanley Cup Final is a new and welcome feeling.
Oh, I'm just pretty excited, it's just a real exciting time. I can't believe this is happening to me, and, coming over from Detroit and, trying to make their team this summer, and now here I am with the Oilers, and we're 1-1 away from winning it all, so just an unbelievable feeling.
Hope you win the game.
Obviously, Murphy's not the only young person hoping the Oilers...
Hard and fast last night, Messier gets the wrong guy as teammate Glenn Anderson is shaken up. But on the next shift, Anderson is back. Sweeney gives the puck up to Simpson. 2-on-1 with Anderson. Good move on Moog in the power play goal. Gave the Oilers an important 1-0 chance as Bill Ranford was frustrating the Beantown boys. Brian Propp is thwarted in the second period.
They weren't allowing any.
Later in the second period, the Oilers go up by 4. Curry across ice to Tikkanen. His shot from a bad angle gets past Moog. 4-0 Oilers after 2. Craig Simpson gets the elbow up on John Carter. Carter gets a headache. Simpson gets a penalty. But Carter shakes out the cobwebs and scores Boston's only goal of the night. The shot finds its way past Ranford to spoil Billy's shutout bid with 5 minutes to go in the game. But the Oilers' big line were looking for more. Anderson wants the hat trick.
These are the best of times. At the International Airport, it was a party for the players. And they deserve it. And some of the players were still partying.
First one.
Well, it's a little more special because we weren't expected to win it in September, and it makes it a little sweeter.
How's it feeling, Glenn?
Unbelievable right now. It's great.
Were you expecting this?
Well, not this big, but it's great. I love it. Love every bit of it. Well,
this is incredible. What a feeling to win the Stanley Cup. And I was training to make the Detroit Red Wings, and I got involved in the trade, and I feel very fortunate. I got a chance to play here, and I just can't thank the organization enough, and this is unbelievable.
Your eyes, I get lost, I get washed away.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Commonwealth Stadium for what has almost become an annual rite of spring in Edmonton, a Stanley Cup victory party. For the fifth time in 7 years, the Oilers have brought the Stanley Cup home, and this one seems a lot sweeter than some of the others, with so many youngsters winning and this one being so unexpected. Almost 20,000 fans have jammed Commonwealth Stadium to honor the champions and welcome Stanley home.
Thank you. It's the greatest feeling in the world, isn't it, to be a champion? The other night, my wife and my family had a victory party, and my wife made the most delicious dessert I've ever tasted. It was Boston creamed pie.
Yeah.
been so proud in my life to be associated with such fine people and talented people as the players of the Edmonton Oilers. Also proud to be able to be part of the team to bring the Stanley Cup back to Alberta and the city of Edmonton and to the greatest fans in the world. Thank you. And now the players of the best hockey team in the world. He'll wear 5 Stanley Cup championship rings. Number 4, Kevin Lowe. Number 5, and what a tremendous playoff season he had, defenseman Steve Smith. Number 6, Jeff Bookaboom. The Booker. Number 7, he scored the game-winning goal in the second game in overtime against Winnipeg, and the game-winning goal in Game 7 against the Jets, Mark Lamb. Number 8, scored the game-winning goal in overtime in Los Angeles. Scored the game-winning goal against the Chicago Blackhawks in Chicago, Joe Murphy. Number 9, Thursday night, he got the first goal in Game 5. Set up the game winner, Glenn Anderson, number 9. Number 10, what a playoff, Esa Tikkanen. Number 12, he came here from Detroit in November. What a great year he had, Adam Graves. Number 14, I can't remember him losing a face-off in Boston, Craig McTavish. Number 16, rock hard Kelly Buchberger. Number 17, scored the game winner in Winnipeg, Game 6. What a playoff, Yari Curry. Number 18, 16 playoff goals, Craig Simpson. Number 20, one of the greatest rookies in the National Hockey League. He's going to be a superstar, Martin Jina. Number 21, he too has 5 Stanley Cup rings, Dr. Randy Gregg. Number 22, he will wear 5 Stanley Cup championship rings. What a playoff season for number 22, Charlie Huddy. Number 25, one of the best young defensemen in the National Hockey League, Jeff Smith. Number 26, he's won 2 Stanley Cup championships with the Edmonton Oilers. Came here from New Jersey in March, and boy, what a playoff he had, and he really got the power play going. Reho Ruotsalainen. Number 28, they don't come any tougher, Craig Muni. Number 29, Vladimir Ruzicka. Number 30, all he did is win the Conn Smythe Trophy, Bill Ranford! Number 31, he couldn't play this year in the playoffs because of an injury, but he's a big part of this organization, Greg
Paul, I said it before, anytime you win something that you've always had a goal to win ever since you're a little guy, you have to consider yourself fortunate, and then to be able to share it with not only the guys on the team, the organization, but the city, you know, that you play in. And without the fans and without the media and without all this extra stuff, you know, hockey's a game, and it's meant to stay that way. You know, you have to have fun. But this is the way to celebrate right here.
Can you describe the last 48 hours for me?
It's a blur. I don't know. I'm blue like that. It's gone so fast. It's been fun. But it's been a lot of fun.
What are your plans for the summer?
I'm going back to Windsor because I go to university in Windsor in the summers. And then I'm going to go back to Toronto for maybe a month and a half. And then back here for the start of the season. Because I guess when you last this long, the summer's a little shorter. But I'll sacrifice anytime.
Glenn Anderson, who has probably celebrated as much as anybody the past 48 hours or so. That's quite a welcoming committee.
Well, most definitely. They're unbelievable. You can't help but notice the fans. They're great out there. But we're simply the best. Better than all the rest.
You know, this one, for the fans and for you guys, has been more enthusiastic than I think some of the others.
I think so. I'm losing my voice over it. I can't believe it. I'm more excited than any other one, for sure, most definitely. And we played our hearts out. I mean, we deserved every bit of it. And now we're getting the credit, and I love it.
Can you tell us what your plans are for the summer?
Well, I'm going to go down to the Bahamas as soon as these festivities settle down a little bit and relax there for a while. And the only ice I might find will be in my orange juice.
And then it's back on the ice in September.
I think so, isn't it? That's a long way away. I'm not even thinking about that.
We'll worry about that later. Exactly. All right, Glenn Anderson, thanks very much. In the crowd.
These Oilers fans say after five Stanley Cup victories, the city finally did it right, organizing a rally on a Sunday so that
Stanley Cup victory party here at Commonwealth Stadium. If you missed part of it or would like to tape it, we'll rerun this broadcast again at 11:15 tonight following the late local news. And a reminder that coming up Thursday on Edmonton's Newsday, a special half hour chronicling the Oilers Championship Series. That's Thursday at 6:30. Now for everyone involved with the Edmonton Newsday crew, Chris Cuthbert saying so long from Commonwealth Stadium. You're simply the best. We'll be right back.
1991. There will be no changes to the contract. Both sides have agreed. Curry says it's a done deal. Oiler general manager Glenn Sather, who is ice fishing in Iceland, said he tried everything to keep Curry in Edmonton and, as expected, doesn't want to lose, of course, one of the great players, but what could he do? Earlier today, Bruce Buchanan talked with Curry via the telephone from his hotel room in Savonlinna, Finland.
Something just has to happen, and it happens, and, tough to say more than that right now, because it's hard to say how it's going to feel, because it's still summer, and, it's going more. We can know more when the summer, so, when the September comes. There's lots of reasons. That's one of the reasons, and, the kids are 5 years old, I have to, I like to get some more time with them, and because to play in there, it takes a lot of time, and the kids just grow by you, you know what I mean? And the world champions are coming up, it's an interesting situation, and 10 years in the one place, it's been a good place, and good time, and but, there's times that you have to make some decisions, and I felt it's the year for me to do it.
Curry leaves some fond memories behind after spending 10 years as an NHLer in Edmonton.
It's been a good time, and there's a lot of memories, just to be a part of it. In a great team like the Oilers had, and the five Stanley Cups, and the playing with the Kretz, those are the things you can't forget, Plus, you spent 10 years, such great teammates like Mets and Kevin and Andy and all those guys, it's tough to put in the words, but those guys have meant a lot,
Presently, Curry has no plans to return to the NHL. Oilers are keeping him on their protected list. Jari is only 26 goals away from 500.
I really don't look at it that way. I don't think that will happen. Right now, I feel that it's not going to finish in Europe somewhere. No. But, I can't say no, but the way I look at it right now, it's going to look like that we're going to finish in Europe.
Good luck, Jari. Bruce Buchanan, ITV Sports.
Selected right winger Jari Curry in the third round of the 1980 draft out of Finland. They knew they were getting a talented hockey player, but what they really got was a developing superstar. It was evident that first season Curry was a gifted goal scorer that could play both offense and defense. In his rookie NHL season, Curry scored 32 goals, and there would be plenty more. Curry would be teamed with Wayne Gretzky, and the combination would prove to be deadly for the opposition. The Gretzky to Curry, then the one-timer, would be repeated many times over the next eight seasons. In the 1983-84 season, his fourth at Edmonton, Curry broke the 50 goals in a season plateau. The first of four seasons, he would break that barrier. The next season, 84-85, Curry went on a scoring binge. Scoring 71 goals in just 73 games, was awarded the Lady Byng Trophy, and was selected a first-team All-Star for the first time. In the playoffs in the spring of 85, Curry scored 19 playoff goals in 18 games to help the Oilers win their second straight Stanley Cup. Curry had 68 goals the following season and 54 the season after that. Another first-team All-Star selection and another Stanley Cup ring. In the summer of 1988, Curry's longtime linemate Wayne Gretzky was dealt to the Kings. And the question surrounding Jari, what kind of player would he be without number 99? Well, Curry proved without a doubt he was more than just Gretzky's sidekick. But he could be effective without the game's best player. He had 44 goals in his first season without Wayne. When the two were reunited for the 89 All-Star Game at Northlands Coliseum, it was like they had never been separated, Gretzky to Curry. And we realize again there was something special between these two players. This past spring, Curry passed Gretzky for the record for most goals in the playoffs. Curry scored his 92nd goal against Boston, which is now the new mark. But after five Stanley Cups, 474 goals and over 1,000 points, and a dream to play for his home country, it was obvious that Curry wouldn't be back in Edmonton.
We had the World Championships in Finland in 1991, and we haven't won a medal in the tennis national team ever, so that's something that
It would be nice to.
Goal-scoring leader last spring, surpassing Wayne Gretzky. Curry has 92 playoff goals, 202 playoff points, making him number two overall in that category. Curry's one of only 26 players to surpass the 1,000-point plateau in the regular season. He signed a two-year deal with
the weekend highlights with Al Nagy.
Rosie Jones.
Year. General manager Glenn Sather's in Iceland fishing right now, and he expressed profound regret that Curry is leaving. He said
Long Stony Plain Road near 185th Street had to be evacuated. The situation was described as extremely dangerous as more than 50 firefighters were on the scene fearing an explosion. Newsday's Rick Boguski reports.
You could smell the gas for blocks as it spewed from the broken line. Construction crews were busy working on a parking lot next to CFRN television around 7:30 this evening when the gas line broke.
I think the person who was in the most danger was the operator of the Bobcat at the time that the Bobcat hit the pipeline. From the looks of it, he took the time to move the Bobcat away from the pipeline.
What could have happened then to the Bobcat operator?
It could have been engulfed in flames.
More than 50 firemen were on scene. Stony Plain Road was closed and the area was cordoned off for a four-block radius. Power was shut off. CFRN TV was forced off the air. Businesses and hotels all along the strip had to be evacuated.
What are you going to do in the meantime?
Don't ask me. I don't really know.
I
said to think everything we own is back there. We've got nothing else with us if anything happens.
Well, the fire department continued to map out a plan this evening. The deputy fire chief described the situation as extremely dangerous.
Okay, in the event that we do have it turns into a problem, when we have taken a proactive approach to looking after the incident.
How dangerous is this situation right
now?
Very
dangerous. It's a potential that it could be very bad.
The fire department said just the slightest spark could set the gas off. And as the wind died down, the situation grew more dangerous. The utility company was already busy trying to shut the line down, but the main valve is more than 30 blocks away and it will take time to bleed the line. Emergency crews are still on the scene. Rick Boguski, CBC News, Edmonton.
Joining us now on the phone from the command center is Jerry Maneg with Northwestern Utilities. Mr. Maneg, why did it take so long to shut the gas off?
There were several sources of gas that had to be located. Several valve assemblies that had to be shut off in order to isolate the section of pipeline where the break occurred. We managed to do that by 10:20 this evening.
Just how much gas leaked?
I can't give you that amount. It was leaking for several hours. The pipeline, it's a high-pressure pipeline that was operating at about 380 pounds. It's very difficult for me to estimate off the top of my head how much gas actually flowed.
So just how dangerous would you rate the situation tonight?
Well, it was serious enough that the fire department felt it necessary to evacuate the television station that is nearby, as well as the Relax Inn. In addition, power was shut off to the area. Those are precautions that you have to take when you have the potential of gas migrating into adjacent areas.
Now, the gas is still in the area, obviously. What kind of danger does that pose to the people in the area right now?
The gas has been shut off now, and so there is no danger any longer.
All right, Mr. Maneg, thanks for talking to us. On the line now is Newsday reporter Holly Doan. She remains on the scene tonight. Holly, we just heard from Mr. Maneg that the gas leak has been shut off. What's happening out there right now?
Well, the crowd has thinned a bit considerably, but what they're doing now is figuring out what happens tomorrow morning because, as you know, the area has been evacuated. That includes the hotels, the dealerships, the restaurants, and 900 mobile homes in the Westview Mobile Home Park Village, which is just south of Stony Plain Road, about 183rd, 184th Street. So those people are out of their homes still. They can return, but they have no power, no water. And there will be some other spotty areas.
As for blocks as it spewed from the broken line, construction crews were working on a parking lot next to CFRN television when the line broke. Firefighters were afraid there could be a major explosion, but crews have been able to shut off the flow of gas. People who were evacuated from the area are now being allowed to return. However, power and water to the area may not be...
Last night's gas leak was caused when a Bobcat operator struck and punctured a high-pressure gas line in the CFRN Broadcasting House parking lot. Firefighters ordered the evacuation of about 200 people from homes and businesses within a four-block area as a precautionary measure.
Well, there's always a danger.
Utilities got a call from the city fire department. Natural gas was spewing from a high-pressure pipeline in the parking lot of Sunwapta Broadcasting. A Bobcat had punctured the line. The situation was dangerous. The fire department's dangerous goods and rescue teams responded immediately. City police cordoned off Stony Plain Road from 178th Street west to 215th Street. The smell of natural gas hung heavy in the air. A loud hissing could be heard for blocks. Despite this, many West End residents had no idea what had happened.
I didn't realize that's a possibility.
As the night wore on, people displaced by the leak waited behind police barricades.
Angry that we have to sit out on the street and get bit to pieces by mosquitoes? Surely somebody can come and get us and take us somewhere for a couple of hours till it's all over with.
Wanda Gillett had more than just herself to look after.
Yeah, she's getting a little tired, yeah.
While many wanted to leave, some insisted on staying.
While I'm here watching my building won't go on fire.
For those forced onto the street, city buses arrived to take them to Jasper Place Composite High School. There was both criticism and praise.
There wasn't a plan as to what was going to happen to the people.
They were allowed back. By 11 p.m., the gas line was shut off, so the power was restored to the area. Police lines came down. For the 120 residents of Vistula Mobile Home Park, the evacuation provided some anxious moments. And as
the dollars and damage. Today, those who lived through the terrible event are getting on with their lives.
July 31st, 1987 is a day that will live in infamy in Edmonton. It was a day that this city went through what most only believed happened in the movies. Only this was real. Late in the afternoon, a tornado struck down in the southeast part of the city. It would touch down several more times, leaving a path of death and destruction before leaving the area. It was the Evergreen Mobile Home Park that suffered the most effects of the tornado. It was here the tornado claimed 15 of a total of 27 lives. 200 of 600 trailers were destroyed. 3 years later, those at the park that lived through the tragedy have long since put their lives together, although they can never completely forget. Tammy Catcher was 14. Tornado hit the city today is the fact there is a more efficient warning system, and that the public now takes weather warnings more seriously than before the tornado of 87. Earl Morgan, Eyewitness News.
Ago, when the sky over Edmonton turned dark and a tornado claimed 27 lives, causing widespread damage at the same time. For many Edmontonians, only time can heal the wounds which have left or were left in the tornado's wake. John Loveland reports.
3 years ago today, a tornado forever changed Edmonton.
Moments later, Connolly and his wife lay buried somewhere beneath this rubble at the Evergreen Trailer Park. And this is where they stayed for more than an hour before neighbors rescued them. Glenn Connolly escaped with just a few bruises. His wife, Pat, wasn't as lucky. Both her heart and lungs were punctured. Now she can do little more than rest. An oxygen tank never far from her side.
Nope.
27 people died in the tornado. Twisted metal and destroyed homes stretched all along the eastern edge of the city. The hardest hit the Evergreen Trailer Park.
Gas was spewing from a high-pressure pipeline in the parking lot of Sunwapta Broadcasting. A Bobcat had punctured the line. The situation was dangerous. The fire department's dangerous goods and rescue teams responded immediately. City police cordoned off Stony Plain Park.
Of CBC Sports. The Edmonton Eskimos are still smarting from an upset loss to Ottawa last week. They'll try to get back on track at the expense of the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. But the Bombers have home field advantage and lots of confidence after a fast start. It is Edmonton versus Winnipeg to start week four on the CFL on CBC. Only a few years ago, the Bombers were led by one of the CFL's all-time great quarterbacks.
Tom Clements retired, the search began for a replacement. Sean Salisbury had a crack at the job, long enough to share in one Grey Cup. While Salisbury struggled last year, Tom Burgess was growing discontent with his role in Saskatchewan. He wanted to be number one, and with Winnipeg, he is. The Bombers hope his acquisition means the search for Clements' replacement is over. Burgess has had his moments to start the season, but it's been the play of the defense that's had the most to do with the Bombers' surprising 2-1 record. Tracy Hamm, who can shake off injuries, has had everything to do with the Eskimos' winning record. As far as CFL quarterbacks go, Hamm is state-of-the-art. He can run as well as most running backs, and he can throw as well as any quarterback. He did get a reminder in Ottawa last week that he's only human, as did all the Eskimos, who lost a race to 50 with the Rough Riders. Hamm was up and running the next day, and Joe Farragelli knows his best chance of winning is with Hamm at quarterback.
Is a presentation of Mole Star Communications.
Well, here it goes. For the win. And Flutie's in the hole. It is up, and it is good. Last week, Louis Passaglia made good his 484th CFL field goal, the league's all-time leader in that department. And tonight, he could become the CFL's all-time leading scorer. Louis Passaglia needs 11 points in this game by single convert field goal, or even by touchdown, to surpass Dave Cutler's record. Cutler, 2,237 points as an Edmonton Eskimo. He began in 69. He retired with a record in 1984.
I don't think you really ever own records. You just kind of borrow them for a while. And I think the way athletics has gone, and especially with, you know, so much television athletics that people have seen, that what used to be the benchmarks are, you know, falling on a consistent basis. And, you know, it's bound to leave, you know, the Eskimo hands and pass into somebody else's hands. And I'm just really glad for Louis because he's, and I genuinely mean this, a very, very class guy.
We go back a long ways. I've been watching him for, what, 20-odd years prior to getting to this point in time. When I first started at Simon Fraser in 19-odd, whatever it was, he was a guy that, if you were into the profession of kicking, he was a guy that everybody watched. When you talked about field goal kickers, you talked about Dave Cutler. So for me, it's a special moment tonight if I do get a chance to break it. Not only because he's a great kicker, but because he's a good friend also.
Louis Passaglia could make history tonight, and don't you know he won?
They're afraid.
Where he and the BC Lions are at BC Play Stadium against the Saskatchewan.
The traffic problems are expected to last for 3 months while the construction continues. The work has forced the closure of three...
The southwest end where developers are currently building on one of the last areas accessible by roads and that are serviced by city utilities. To start newer areas will mean building new roads. That takes money the city doesn't have. But the several companies we contacted declined to be interviewed. The city study into how to service newer areas with roadways and other municipal services is expected to take about 8 months. Without a solution, the city transportation department manager warns there can be no new...
Alexander and the BC Lions go to Saskatchewan. Alexander wears some orange in his uniform and underneath Bobby Jurison's helmet. Might be a bandana made for the Lions. BC at Saskatchewan, 9:30 Eastern Time, Tuesday on CFN. The kickoff returns a long one, set up another major by Brock Smith, and so add up the yardage, and you've got well over 200 yards in combined offense. For number 83 tonight, Derek Crawford really putting his stamp, if you'll excuse the pun, on but they got a whole lot more points, and that's the way the Stampeders have been doing it this season. Two games. games in the CFL tonight. Dean Dorsey missed a last-minute field goal from inside the 40-yard line that would have won it for the Ottawa Rough Riders. Instead, they remain in last place, and the Ticats move into a second-place Eastern tie with the Argos. Hamilton wins by a point. Here in Calgary, the Stampeders did it both ways, with offense and with defense. Joe Clausy picked off two passes in the end zone. The Stampeders hold the Argos to 17 points, score 42 themselves, and Calgary remains undefeated. Next Tuesday, it's Week 6, BC at Saskatchewan, and CFN has coverage of Calgary at Edmonton as well. Two games for the price of one.
Reports.
The Transportation Department is pushing for a surface LRT that would save more than $100 million over a partially underground alternative. The proposed route would link University Farm and the West Edmonton Mall via Fox Drive, the White Mud, over the Quesnel Bridge to 149th Street, where it would head west to the mall, rather than tunneling under University Avenue. And at least one councillor openly supports the proposal. Accepts the recommendation of the Transportation Department, it would still be years before any construction begins.
We are at this point in time, the two roadways.
Construction on the LRT bound for the West End is projected for night.
Go West is the call now facing Edmonton's LRT. But city planners have come to a fork in the road. The city now has to choose from two very different paths to lead the line out to West Edmonton Mall. Their first option, Route 1, is a more direct path from the university, but it involves the creation of a bridge, almost 3 kilometers of tunnel work, and extensive engineering. The Transportation Department would prefer to skip this $240 million idea.
Our river valley is fairly active in terms of slides and so on, usually difficult soil conditions, so in addition to the expense, it's also very, very difficult technically.
The latest proposal for a West End link starts at the University Farm and travels along Fox and White Mud Drives over the Quesnel Bridge until patching into 87th Avenue. Because most of it is above ground, it would take about half the time to build. However, its key sell point is its price tag.
It's about $100 million difference, and you can't argue with that.
This particular proposal basically is along an existing transportation corridor, so although it will have an impact, it's probably minimal.
The city is trying to look well into the future with this project. The Transportation Department wants to start laying down the LRT's West End connection by the late 90s, and so they're hoping council will choose a direction tomorrow. Alderman Bruce Campbell doesn't...
This month's feature bouquet is specially priced.
The precision of Chart Laser four-way laser alignment, plus free power polishing, free lifetime warranty, and free touch-up paint.
New trends in hair design are smooth and soft. A more relaxed look is making a comeback. This year, natural is...
So far, the LRT system has had only a very minor impact on Edmonton's River Valley.
Even though trees and shrubs near the south end of the high-level bridge have been torn out for the LRT extension to the university, the damage there has been confined to a relatively small area.
In the future, though, it's going to become more and more difficult for the city to avoid digging up the river valley to expand the LRT to other parts of Edmonton.
The next most important leg is to West.
West, after a line to Southgate has been completed. One line could run underground from the University Health Sciences Center along University Avenue, across the river on a new bridge, and above ground up 87th Avenue to West Edmonton Mall. The other line would run above ground along Fox Drive from the University Farm, across the Quesnel Bridge, up the freeway to 149th Street, and from there, it would join up with 87th Avenue.
There's no doubt about it that both
Avenue across the river, the city would have to tear out trees on the east side of the river valley and run tracks across untouched flatlands on the west side. To build the second line, grass and woodland near the White Mud Equine Center and the White Mud Park would have to be torn up.
Come straight up on 2 until you get to White Mud Drive.
If not for the mall, for a lot of other things. Edmonton's summer festivals have drawn in record numbers. People from around the globe have come for the law enforcement and Indigenous people's games. And the number of conferences and conventions in town is reportedly up. In fact, the overall number of people visiting is expected to reach 6 million before year's end. That despite higher costs in Canada than in the U.S.
Actually, we hear it a lot. Our prices, I think, up here are still a little higher than they would be in the States. But they come anyway. Sure, they come anyway.
And they seem to be coming a long way, bypassing Calgary right into Edmonton.
Well, Calgary, again, is also, you know, one of the top cities in Alberta. They have proximity to Banff, which is certainly a very good advantage for them in the tourist market.
But no mall.
But no mall, and that's one of our key attractions.
But the mall isn't the only attraction reporting increased numbers. Fort Edmonton Park has had one of its best summers yet, and predicts an added 25,000 people will visit over last year.
A lot of people come to Edmonton because of West Edmonton Mall. A lot of people, after spending some time at the mall, they want to see what else Edmonton has to offer, and the city has an awful lot to offer, and Fort Edmonton Park is one of those major items.
The actual tourism staff.
Thanks for being with us tonight. We'll see you tomorrow night.
Good night.
Au revoir.
In 4 years, but West Edmonton Mall has finally agreed to pay compensation to a young man badly injured on the Mindbender roller coaster. 29-year-old Rodney Chaco was the sole survivor of a spectacular accident in 1986 that killed his best friend and a young Edmonton couple engaged to be married. Linda Steele has more.
The Mindbender roller coaster at West Edmonton Mall was designed to give riders the thrill of their lives, speeds of up to 100 kilometers an hour. The illusion of danger was supposed to be just that, an illusion. But on June 14, 1986, the danger was very real. One of the coaster cars suddenly lost its wheels and began whipping around the track, flinging its four passengers to the ground. Three of them died. Edmonton welder Rodney Chaco was the only survivor.
It just happened at once. The ride started fishtailing, and then it hit the pillars, and then it was just so fast that you couldn't do nothing to hold yourself.
Chaco was badly injured in the accident. His legs completely shattered below the knees.
They say I can't even think of a career now. My next 2 years are of trying to learn how to walk.
But Chaco was back on his feet sooner than he expected, walking with the aid of steel leg braces just 6 months after the devastating accident.
In court for trying to kill a police officer.
Running for their lives, foreigners escape war-torn Kuwait.
Belly up, why are these fish dying in Lake Isle?
If the sound doesn't get you, the fillings might.
And I'm Colin McLean. Tonight on our Festival City coverage, reviewing My Blue Heaven. Rick Moranis and Steve Martin star in a film that's definitely not heavenly.
From CBC Edmonton's.
He misses Edmonton and his favorite hockey team, the Oilers.
Accident. The truck was turning off the highway when it tipped over. The driver and a passenger were taken to Grey Nuns Hospital. The truck was used for paving and a mixture of tar spread over the... when a load of egg cartons caught fire. The damage was kept to the trailer. Two workers...
Presentation of Mole Star Communications.
Today on the Canadian Football Network, the Eskimos' defense continues its assault while the Riders search for a return to the good time. Also today, a look at what makes a rookie kicker tick. And a quarterback reflects on what could have been. More on one player's overtures to move and another's efforts to make the Prairies a home.
It's the first day game of the season here at Taylor Field on the Canadian Football Network.
This is Molson, Canadian Football Network.
Breaks of the barricades, the military and the Mohawks meet face to face.
And I'm Colin McLean. Later on our Festival City coverage, a new hand at the tiller of the fringe, Judy Lawrence, takes over.
From CBC Edmonton, this is Edmonton's Newsday with Joanne Stefanik.
Mood to fool around. Football, August 27th home game. Yeah, and I thanks for being with us tonight.
Good night.
Au revoir.
OV, real life beer.
Priority Courier, the official courier of the CFL.
Winnipeg renew their Eastern rivalry. Ty Jones and the Bomber defense will try to stop Darryl Smith and the Toronto Argo offense that broke loose for 41 points in Ottawa last week. Join us Wednesday for the Blue Bombers and the Argos from the Sky Dome in Toronto on CFN.
These guys are the reason it's so exciting. Let me show you what I mean. The Eskimos will be on the field, and we need you in the stands. So call 429-ESKS and get your tickets.
Monday, August 27th, the Eskimos host the Toronto Argos. For tickets, call 429-ESKS.
Paglia will remember, but not all the memories will be fond. This was the record-breaking convert that shattered Dave Cutler's all-time scoring record, Paglia's 2,238 point. He would then go on to miss field goals, three of them in all. And this was the winning score, Mike Kerrigan to Richard Nurse with 24 seconds left as the Hamilton Tiger Cats rally to beat the BC Lions. We hope you'll join us Wednesday from the Sky Dome in Toronto when the Blue Bombers will play the Argos. 7:30 Eastern time, Winnipeg at 4-2. Now tied for first in the East with 4-3 Hamilton. The Argos at 3-3, and they could create a three-way tie if they can beat Winnipeg. And we'll have that game from the Sky Dome at 7:30 Eastern time. Here at BC Place, a thriller. The Ticats win by two. Bob Irving for Nick Bastia and everybody involved saying goodnight from Vancouver.
On Edmonton's News Day, Iraq moves new missiles into Kuwait capable of firing chemical weapons. Worried about a nurses' strike, these folks are among thousands who would be affected. Back home, and a bit bored?
A daytime TV is no hell.
I'm Al Nagy. In sports, the Trappers are back home, poised and ready to claim their first division title since 1984.
And I'm Colin McLean. Tonight on our Festival City coverage, what to see, what not to see. More reviews of fringe plays.
The heart of the downtown core. But soon, this former CN site will no longer be urban blight.
This is the main
part will be April of 1991, with a completion date set for 1993. John Berry, Eyewitness News.
Evidence of the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait and this woman's gripping account of her escape.
They're in last place because they